You might think that baby boomers and Generation Z are worlds apart in their work ethic and values. However, our latest research challenges those assumptions, revealing surprising similarities and debunking some common stereotypes. So, in today's episode, we are exploring how each generation approaches work, what they value most in their colleagues, and how these insights can help create more harmonious and productive workplaces. So joining me to do just that is McCrindle's Managing Director, Sophie Renton. Soph, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Always a delight.
Alrighty, Soph, in this latest study, we did investigate some common stereotypes about younger generations, particularly Gen Z when it comes to work ethic. What did the study reveal about these perceptions and how Gen Z are sort of challenging them?
Yeah, so there's lots of perceptions around Gen Z, and you don't have to, I guess, look far in the workplace for a little bit of tension. But as we always say, there's always nuance to the tension. And I think our study highlighted some of that nuance quite well. And I guess even challenged some of our own stereotypes, because, you know, you always have a hypothesis as you put a question in field and you're like, oh, I think it's going to end up like this. And we asked the question around, you know, what would you do if you completed your work tasks before the workday is over? Would you find additional tasks to fulfill your hours, or would you sign off for the day because you've completed your tasks? And we gave a scale for strength on either side. And there was a little bit of a hypothesis that maybe Gen Z might say, oh, I've done my work for the day, I'll sign off. Now, when we actually did the analysis, we combined all three of the options for finding additional tasks to fulfill the hours. So much more likely, somewhat more likely, or slightly more likely. And there wasn't actually that much difference between the generations there. So all of the generations were more likely to find additional tasks than to sign off for the day, which was like, oh, that's great. People are actually really committed to working hard. What was interesting, though, was when we looked into those that were much more likely to find those additional tasks, and that's when our baby boomers and our Gen Xers, more than half, fell into that category. But only just over a third of Gen Z fell into that category. And I think this is where some of that stereotype comes from of, oh, Gen Z, they don't want to work hard. And it's not that they don't want to work hard. It's more that they just want to make sure that they're working hard on the right thing. They don't want to just come and do a 9-to-5 and fill the hours. They want to make sure that the work they're doing is actually accomplishing the tasks and the goals and the objectives of the business itself. And so I think there's tension, there's nuance, and Gen Z aren't as lazy as people might think.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess because we talked about this a bit, you know, when we were formulating this study, and there was that hypothesis that older generations have where they're like, oh, if I finish all my work, then I'm loyal and hardworking, so I'll go and find more tasks because I'm paid for these hours. And yeah, I think these insights did show that all generations are willing to finish the work and, you know, do the hours that they have to do. But like you said, Gen Z probably need a bit more clarity on, you know, the purpose of what they're doing. And we talk a lot about Gen Z, you know, needing to connect to the purpose and the vision of the organization and to see, you know, that they're not a cog in the wheel, but they've got value and meaning, and they're not afraid to go and find other work if they don't get that. They're willing to kind of change jobs more frequently, whereas older generations probably didn't have that same confidence to do that. So yeah, it's fascinating to see how these generations differ. And one of the other questions we asked, which I found quite interesting, which links to this, is the values or the characteristics that they're looking for in their colleagues. And I remember hardworking was the one that came at the top for every generation. But again, when you looked at the percentage, it was higher among the older generations. They value that more. So what kind of other questions or insights did the study reveal about the values and priorities of, say, our oldest working generation, the baby boomers in the workplace, compared to those of the younger generations? What are the similarities? What are some of those key differences?
Yeah, I think that insight that you just pulled out around what qualities people value in a team member at work was one of those really interesting ones, that everyone is looking for a colleague that is hardworking, but it is so much more important to our baby boomers than to maybe our Gen Zs. And then we looked down that list and you had organized, you had approachable, you had problem solver, and those were pretty much the top three across all the different generations. And it was interesting when you came into, well, what's their fifth most desired characteristic to have in a colleague? And for Gen Zs, it was actually self-awareness. And I think that's not actually that surprising, considering they're a generation that has grown up talking a lot more about mental health and awareness around that. And it's just more acceptable to talk about it now than it maybe was for the baby boomer generation. And you spoke to this on our virtual event that you actually shared that, you know, every generation wants to work with people that are self-aware. Like it is a very good thing, but it's just of more importance to our Gen Zs. Whereas if you look at our baby boomers, they really value colleagues that have a high level of integrity. And you can look at the upbringing and the timing of when baby boomers were shaped, and you can totally understand where that desire for integrity comes from. And I think anytime we're talking about generations, it's so important to refer back to the time when people were shaped, or refer back to the context in which they actually entered the workforce, because that shapes so many of their behaviors and their expectations and the way that they choose to engage with the different generations.
Yeah, absolutely. That particular comment on self-awareness also reminded me of an event recently I was speaking at and sharing some insights, and someone came up to me and said, oh, the challenge that they're experiencing is that older workers are saying certain things that younger generations are like, you can't say that. Why are you not being self-aware? Or why, you know, in this era of cancel culture, like, oh, you can't, that's coming across as ignorant. And that's where some of that disharmony was happening. So it's interesting, even I think that idea of self-awareness and how much more valuable Gen Z are kind of reporting that to be for them, and that they're finding it hard to work with people who aren't self-aware. And like you said, because the older generations haven't been taught about the same values that younger generations have through media, through popular culture, through TikTok, you know, it's a whole contextual piece that when you understand that, you go, okay, that's why you don't value this and that's why I do. And learning to work in the midst of all that difference is really important.
Totally. And that's where I think having the environment where there's high trust and high respect for the individual goes such a long way, because as soon as you can make someone an other or make someone a group, it's easy to write them off. But the moment that someone becomes a person with thoughts, emotions, experiences, and a story, it invokes empathy in us. It invokes a desire to understand. And I think if we're leading organizations, we need to always be working to make sure that people see people as people and not see people as a collective group or an other. But if they see them as an individual, take the time to know their story, take the time to hear their heart, their concern, it goes such a long way to building social cohesion in the workplace.
Yeah, I love that what you just said. And even like, I guess the way to think about it is like to our colleagues, or to people who don't know me, I'm a millennial, but to all of our team, I am Ashley Fell with XYZ story and XYZ context, in the same way that you're a millennial, Soph, but you're Sophie Renton and you've got this and you bring this. And, you know, when you actually get to know the individual behind the generation they belong to or whatever kind of identifier it might be, it's that's, like you said, how you have empathy, how you have understanding. So, yeah, absolutely vital wisdom there. I feel a bit shell-shocked by that statement, so thanks for saying that, Soph. It was really quite profound. I guess, you know, we talk about difference here and challenges, but there's also ways that different generations complement each other and they bring different skills to the workplace. What kind of unique strengths do you think, you know, just broadly speaking, each generation is kind of bringing to the team, and how can we leverage creating environments where those strengths are sort of valued?
I love talking about this because I think every generation has something to bring to every organization and every community, and we need to take the time to understand that and then create an environment where someone can actually offer their strength to the team. And, you know, our baby boomers, like, I just want to champion baby boomers, and I'm sorry you get such a bad rap in every piece of generational analysis, but you guys are incredible. Like, so much of what we live in today, you have built and you have soldiered on and you have sacrificed for us to sit here as millennials a little bit and maybe complain or point a finger, but you worked for it through blood, sweat and tears. So this is me just saying thank you first up. But I think what baby boomers really bring is a lot of stability to organizations. They've got so much experience and wisdom that they've seen life cycles of business, and they can have that perspective of this too shall pass. We can get through this. We'll weather the storm. We'll be okay. And bringing that stability to a business is really powerful. I think Gen X, there's so much expertise that they have brought into the business world or organizations. And, you know, Gen X, you also kind of get not a bad rap, you just kind of get forgotten. And I'm sorry, I'm an advocate of Gen X. And you really had to wrestle as a bridge generation between baby boomers, between millennials. You were the ones that brought in, you know, computers, emails. So much of today's workplace actually rests on the innovation of Gen X. And Gen X has always been someone that's wanted to do things out of the box. And, you know, you were the first kind of people that paved the way. So thank you. And just keep pushing that envelope forward. But I think for our Gen X, we really need to recognize what they've done. And, you know, they're so good at just getting things done and they're not really about it for their own glory. But let's actually just champion and recognize what these sometimes silent achievers are just getting done in the background of every organization. And then our Gen Ys are bringing that, you know, innovation to the workplace. They're stepping into leadership. They're bringing a different style of leadership, one that's really collaborative, one that's empathy driven, one that's approachable, which our Gen Zs are really responding to. And I know that's maybe a different journey for other generations to lean into on that leadership, but Gen Y is really championing that and they're uniting teams really well. Now, Gen Zs, you are there to kind of push the boundaries and to change things up and keep doing that and leaning into that. And I think if we can create environments where every generation can offer their strength to another, it's really powerful. And in our report, we kind of looked at this concept around diversity that divides or diversity that innovates. And you can have diverse perspectives, and diversity is a topic that's talked about a lot, but it's actually only a strength when it is harnessed. And you can so often have diversity that divides by you've got a problem in the middle, you've got every generation bringing their different perspective, but no one's speaking a common language to be able to actually solve the problem. But when you can bring all of those collective perspectives, all those different experiences, and put the team on the same page, standing together to solve the problem, that's when you get really powerful diversity of an intergenerational team that can bring great solutions.
Yeah, I loved how you were just championing every generation there, and they all had their own kind of statement and positives, and every generation does. They bring different values. And like you said, diversity can be such a strength if it can be harnessed well and it doesn't divide, but it actually allows us to bring different ideas and ways to the table that can allow an organization to, dare I say, pivot or innovate or change to remain relevant for changing consumers or a changing world of work, whatever kind of that focus might be. So diversity is really key, and I guess that's a key part, right, of how organizations can foster better collaboration and understanding between generations. But Soph, do you have any other kind of tips? I mean, you wrote some amazing tips in this report and in that virtual event that we hosted about how we can ensure that everyone from the baby boomers right through to Gen Z and in the few years to come, in even with Gen Alpha moving into the workforce, like how do you feel leaders can help every generation to feel valued and motivated in a workplace context?
Well, I think first and foremost, it is really building that culture of respect for every generation and creating a environment where there is a level of trust between colleagues, where there is a level of vulnerability in an appropriate way, where people can actually acknowledge their strengths and their gaps and say, hey, I've got a gap here, but you've got a strength. Can you help fill that gap? But that can only happen when there is that, I guess, social relationship there to be a foundation for it to be built on. And that comes through bringing mutual respect across the organization. And leadership plays such a crucial role in that. If you're a leader and you don't like what you're seeing in your team in terms of intergenerational connections, then I encourage you to look at your own behavior first, because it always starts at the top and flows down. And if you're not building a culture of respect for every generation, your team won't be either. So you need to set that tone and value every generation. Learn to see the strengths and the opportunities and see it in people and champion them, because everybody has something that they can bring to the workplace.
Yeah,
and then absolutely. Developing. Oh, sorry.
No, I was just going to agree, because it's all such good things you're saying.
And then I think just developing that common language where you get people on the same page. And so often in organizations, we communicate information, but we don't actually communicate something of value, and so much gets lost in translation. And I think we need to make sure that we communicate in a way that people actually walk away understanding. And you can have fun with that, you know, Gen Z slang. And I make the joke that half the time I don't know what our Gen Zs are saying. And, you know, our colleague Abby just dropped a Gen Z slang cheat sheet on my desk the other day as a bit of fun. And, you know, we have generational kind of interactions here. And I think be willing to acknowledge what you don't know and let someone actually offer in their strength in that place. And that's really powerful. And then just have fun. Learn to just enjoy each other, and people want to come to work in a place where they enjoy being with their colleagues. And, you know, people ask me, what's your favorite thing about McCrindle? And first and foremost, I often say the team. I just love the people that we work with, and I love what we get to do together. And that's a really powerful place to be.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, everything you said then always starts with a posture of humility and like admitting when you're wrong or make a mistake or approach something different, or you're not self-aware. Like, I think here we're acknowledging that no generation, no individual is perfect, no colleague is perfect. We all make mistakes, and when there is that kind of dissonance or disconnect across the generations, you know, owning up to when things haven't gone well, or when you as a leader have not set the tone and you want to change that. So having that posture of humility, I think, is a great quality of any great leader, but also when you're leading intergenerational teams where everyone does, like you said, feel valued and motivated, is incredibly important. So yeah, thank you so much, Sophie, for being a great leader who models all of this, who has worked very hard on various reports that we've written, including this latest one, which is cultivating healthy intergenerational teams. You and I have been out and about speaking about this research at various conferences and events, and a lot of people are really, I think, appreciating a lot of the hard work that the team has done, but particularly that you've done as well. So thank you for that, and thank you for your time on the podcast today.
Pleasure. Topic I love.
Me too. And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast, especially as we take a few weeks break from the podcast. I'd also encourage you to access all of our content on McCrindle Plus and go and check that out. And you can also, of course, follow us on social media, or simply head to McCrindle.com and check out some of the resources we have available there. So as always, thank you so much for listening, and bye for now.